I mean, think about designer clothes. I didn't have the money. I bought them in the market, like Wolfram Store Market, proper bootleg.
No way.
Hey.
Hey, guys. So in today's video, we're going to be sharing with you 10 top things that we decided to stop buying in order to make more money.
Yeah.
Now, these changes have had a huge impact on our finances and on our well-being because we were able to maximize our savings and direct those savings towards investments that helped us towards becoming financially independent at the age of 34. And today, we want to share those top 10 things with you.
Yeah. In addition to that, I wanted to say that the mindset for today's video is pretty simple. Although we're going to be talking about big and small ideas, the key thing to remember is that these savings in isolation might look quite small, but the right mindset is to think of them cumulatively and the compounding effects that they have, not just today, but in the future. If you're really enjoying today's video, would really appreciate it if you hit that subscribe button. Show some love for the work that we're putting into our channel. Really appreciate every single one of you who has actually subscribed to our channel. All right, this is gonna be super casual. So we're just gonna just have a bit of a laugh as we talk about them. But the very first thing we stopped buying, slightly odd one, but it's doing house upgrades. This is one that I think a lot of people kind of sleep into because you could be someone who's maybe living in a flat and you're like, you know what, I want my own house and that's fine. Or you could be like, I live in a 2-bed and I want a 3-bed. In fact, I can think of a couple who have got a 3-bed and have one child, but then they're moving into a 5-bed. It's quite natural to want to move up because other people are moving up. But that moving up comes at a real cost. Not just in you borrowing more money, but also moving costs like stamp duty, if I can say the words properly, but also the knock-on effect that has, you know, the opportunity cost of that money in the future. What we've done personally is actually bought a house and stuck with it. We've lived in this house now for 12 years. It's been that long.
Gosh.
And it's going to be like that for a while.
I feel old. Why is it looking?
And doing that has definitely saved us not only a lot of money, but we've not felt the need to want to upgrade. Instead, we've turned our house into a home.
Yeah.
100%. What's our next one?
So the next one is we stopped paying for premium TV subscriptions. Thinking back to when we first got married, we had the expensive Sky, you know, package, but we're not hardcore sports fans.
You know I'm not happy, fam, because come on, blood. I want this league, blood. I would do anything for this league, blood, yeah?
Well, yeah.
And at the time, we didn't really have time to watch much movies, so we just cut it all down. The time that we saved, which we would have been sitting down on a sofa watching TV,
wasting away
like a couch potato, we instead directed all of that extra time to working on our side hustle, which was great for us because we both had corporate jobs and working long hours. So yeah, that definitely helped us. But now fast forward to today, we have introduced a few subscriptions, but it's smaller, way cheaper, and also we get to decide what we want to watch, when we want to watch it, at a budget that we're happy with without like breaking the bank.
Correction. One subscription.
Yeah.
I think that's important. Singular and plural. Quite a big difference. Right. And obviously there's obviously YouTube and things like that.
Exactly. Yeah. You've got YouTube, you've got podcasts, if I can say the word.
Free resources
that you can get without actually having to spend so much money on a monthly subscription.
The third one is paying monthly for expensive cars. Now, I know this is a touchy subject, and I'm going to be real. When it comes to achieving financial freedom, I believe very strongly that financial freedom is never given to you. You have to go and take it. And if you want to become financially free, you have to do what most people are not doing. And most people are paying for cars monthly. Look at data around debt. In the personal debt in the UK, there's a ballooning amount of debt when it comes to car financing. I personally hate the idea of paying for car financing. I'll give you a really good way of thinking about car financing or money you spend on stuff like this more generally. Every pound that you put towards your car finance every single month could have been worth £2 in 10 years, assuming a 7% average return. Yeah, so imagine. So if you're spending £400 a month on a car right now, which a lot of people are standardly, that could have been worth £800 a month in the future. Yeah, just process that for a minute. I know people, for some people, their joyful thing is that they actually have a nice car, you know? But for me, it was all about status. And I've made this mistake. I've done that. And I absolutely hated looking at my bank statement and seeing that amount leave the bank. And I knew it was status driven. I just wanted to have a nice car.
You wanted to get the girls.
Actually, do you know what? This is before we met, you know. So actually, we're gonna come to a really controversial point at the end. You know, point is a bonus point 11, which you don't want to miss. I'm gonna talk about that. But yeah, paying monthly for a car is one thing that we've stopped, and owning our car outright has been the best thing, really. And we're happy with that.
So the next one is falling for regular phone updates. There are some people today, right now, who are going to get a phone call saying, hello, hi there, is this so-and-so? Hi, you're due for a phone upgrade. And those people don't actually know that the phone upgrade is actually optional. It's not a requirement. So some people are signing up to phone upgrades even though their phone is in a great condition.
Yes.
So with us, we've said, look, as long as our phone is still in a great working condition, we're going to keep it until it's on its last leg. Yeah, we're not falling into the trap of getting the next upgrade every single
year. The next shiny thing.
And they usually try to entice you with this like new feature, but there isn't a significant difference between this new model and the previous model.
What's a guide, do you think, for people in terms of how long it would be a decent kind of own a phone for before upgrading? I think it really depends. I personally say at least 3 years. Like, if you can own your phone for at least 3 years, typically contracts last for 2 years. Then you want to obviously own it for longer than that.
You can like even have it for longer.
Way longer. Like, you can own your phone for 7 years if you have to. But they don't make these phones to last that long anymore. We, for example, need our phones for the work we do. So we're always creating, shooting videos, that kind of stuff on the go.
Yeah.
Even with this phone I've had it for 2 years and I'm planning to hold it for even longer.
Yeah.
So,
you know, the benefits of that is that your monthly payments will not increase, but instead it will reduce because you would have paid off for your phone and then all you're paying for is for like the data and so on.
The next one is designer clothes. Now, this is actually a big topic because I was saying to Mary before I started making this video, like, think back to when we were back at, like, maybe 15, 20, 25 years ago even. Like, where was most of our money going?
Designer clothes.
The one thing you said was designer clothes,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
and when you think about designer clothes, I was exactly the same. I didn't even have the money. I bought them in the market, like, Wolfhamstow Market, proper bootleg.
No way. Was that college day?
You know, yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Guys,
anyway, I shouldn't say that.
He was like head to toe in like, what was it? Yeah. Visu, Iceberg.
All those, but a lot of it was
but
fake.
But it weren't real. Oh,
a lot
no.
of it was fake. It was just like stuff you bought in the anyway, digression, but very important point. And I was thinking about why we actually did that. And it made me realize that a lot of people buy designer clothes because it's a status symbol and it makes them feel successful. And it makes them feel successful in the eyes of others. And I was thinking about what made me buy it. Mine wasn't just that I wanted to look successful. It was also because it was a survival mechanism. I wanted to fit in. I think if you're currently someone who is buying designer clothes and there's no judgment whatsoever, it's actually quite important to ask yourself, why are you doing that? And I think acknowledging why you're doing it is actually a pretty important point. I've personally found that wearing stuff like this, which is, you know, it's a decent, nice white t-shirt, right? You know, it's gone through the washing machine, it's done its thing. I'm not panicking as much if this t-shirt doesn't make it through the washing machine. But I'm not going to like lose sleep.
Yeah.
Because I've got other white t-shirts. So I've personally found that having plain clothing without all the designer badges all over it and stuff has certainly given me a lot of peace and it's made me much more self-aware. And I don't feel like I'm trying to like impress anybody. Yeah. Like if I left the house without a watch, like who cares? Like even if I wore my watch, I've probably got it on to count my steps rather than before. I wanted to kind of like, have you seen my watch?
Have you
seen what I'm wearing? You know, it was all of that. I wanted people to see how supposedly successful I was.
But also, I think you don't feel the pressure of having to buy the latest trending designer.
That's the other thing, isn't
that's
it?
That's out there. You know,
because when you
buy something that's designed so expensive, only for you to realize, now this is like last season. You have to buy the most recent one. So number six is daily takeout lunches. Now, those daily takeout lunches were draining my funds when I started my graduate job. And I think that lasted for like a few months. And then I said, enough of this. I'm going to start meal prepping.
Yeah, man.
So from when I was, you know, at home with my parents, whatever I had the night before, I would take that into work the next day. And then when we got married, I encouraged you to do the same. And, you know, we made so much of a saving. Like, if you think about how much you spend on a daily basis, if you buy food when you go to work, it could cost between as little as £3 to £15 or more. And if you just average that to like £5 a day, that's £25 a week or £100 a month. £100 that could be going towards your investments, your stocks and shares, ISA. We made a big saving. Now, don't get me wrong. It doesn't mean that you should be antisocial and not go to any like work lunches, like with your colleagues,
or drinks,
do that, but budget, it's all about balance and budget for it. Have a budget for those social events.
Yeah, I was just going to add about those packed lunches, man. There are times when I just got bored of the meal deal. Like, I just wanted porn, you know, like a nice... I just wanted a really nice sandwich just so I could be like, wow, actually, I feel like I've treated myself. Yeah. But I get exactly what you mean. It all comes back to the same thing. It all adds up.
Yeah, it does.
And you can't have everything at the same time, really. There needs to be some trade-off to get what we want out of life.
But the benefits of that also is that you actually know what you're eating. You can control how healthy kind of the food is. And so, yeah, it's better for your health and for your pockets.
Next one is buying things on credit. Now, I think... buying things on credit is actually pretty interesting because I think it's a default for a lot of people. It's like, I want to buy something. I don't think about it. I don't even think, have I got the money? I just think I can buy it right now.
Payment plans.
I can like buy now, pay later. I almost think of it as buy now, think later, you know? And I almost think, obviously, the most obvious thing this reveals is that one is likely not living within their means. Yeah, and this comes back to super foundational stuff. It's actually pretty important because the more you can train yourself into someone who does not rely on credit when they buy stuff, the more likely you are to be that person who not only lives within their means, but actually build up a bit of a buffer that can then go into other areas like maybe investing in stocks or maybe starting your own small business or whatever. But it actually begins by actually putting some controls in place. And I think a lot of people have zero controls in place when it comes to credit. And the easy access to credit, there's no friction.
At all.
The easy access to credit has actually made debt to become normalized.
Yeah.
So much so that you want something right now, you can get it right now and you can pay later for it without actually thinking. And that is the wrong culture to cultivate.
It's a big trap. Okay, so now number 8 is dining out frequently. Now, whilst we still treat ourselves every now and again, we've definitely cut down on maybe going to the really expensive Michelin. It's not everyday Michelin 5-star. Sometimes you just want to go to a really nice restaurant that's not going to cost an arm and a leg, where we actually feel like we're full up after leaving the restaurant, but we've also enjoyed our food. And we can also get good quality food for a fraction of the price. But also, it's helped that I do a lot of meal prepping now. So, and by meal prepping, I do a lot of cooking in bulk. And so days where we might want to eat out or get a takeaway, we might just instead eat in through the food that we already have at home. It's healthy. We know how what's cooked. We know what ingredients went into
what's gone into it.
And I'm actually happy. I feel joyful eating our home-cooked food as opposed to always eating out.
All right, next one is overpriced gym memberships. Now, I know this is something that is already on a lot of people's radars, but I don't think it's something that a lot of us actually think almost intentionally about what could the alternatives be and to what extent should I make that alternative my reality. So for example, we've always wanted to have a space at home where we could actually do something, do our own workouts. We started at home, started in our living room. So we would move the sofa, we'd turn the living room into a workout space using just a mat and watching YouTube videos and would work out. And that doesn't cost anything. And more recently, we spent a bit of money to use a bit of space we have at home and create a bit of a home gym. But with, again, equipment that doesn't really need a great deal of servicing. So, you know, some dumbbells. Good quality dumbbells, some, you know, got a mat, got like a bench.
Resistance stuff
like that that doesn't really need a lot of maintenance work. The point here is ask yourself, what is it I truly want for my finances, and to what extent are the things I'm spending money on helping me to get there or not? So if you feel that your gym membership, and that's a recurring payment, if you feel that that's actually not getting you to where you want to get to in your finances, and there's an alternative way to achieve the fitness outcomes you have, then you may want to seriously consider not paying for it. I've never looked back since not paying for a gym. But of course, you know, if the gym is your thing, it's the thing that brings you joy, then, you know, please go ahead and keep using your gym.
Well said. Number 10 is brand loyalty blindness. Now, loyalty to brands can cost you. Sometimes generic brands and store-bought brands are just the same, if not better, than the branded alternatives. Just holding up this can of baked beans, it tastes exactly the same as the more popular branded baked beans that you can get from all the major supermarkets. But this costs a fraction of the price. When you do buy some store-branded products, just be careful that you're actually getting the same value in terms of the nutritional benefits. And there's a great app that you can use called Yuka. It's like my favorite app. I scan everything now, and then it tells you whether the item that you're buying is high in sugar content or all of the artificial flavors and stuff. So you know whether the things that you're buying, even though it's cheaper, whether it's still good for you nutritionally.
We don't own any shares in that app, and we've not been paid to mention them, by the
way.
We're just talking about it because we use it. Yeah. Anyway, the bonus point I want to make, this might be a bit controversial, but I want to see you guys in the comments, yeah? Is we stopped, I say we, we stopped spending too much money on useless dates.
How do you know it's a useless date?
Useless, that's right.
Talk about this.
So yeah, I spoke at this event and I finished, and I was walking to the station. This young guy walks with me. He's like, hey, love what you're doing. Let's chat. And we're walking, talking. It turned out, speaking to him, that most of his money, like in the hundreds, in that month alone, had gone to dates that were not going to go anywhere. Like, they were just, call them acquaintances or people you meet on dating apps. Essentially, he's trying to, you know, do the dating thing.
Early stages, getting to,
you know, but it's very, very expensive. So I want to know from you guys, right? I'm not dating. I'm like, obviously, I'm married to my beautiful, beautiful wife. I've not been in that dating world for more than a decade. So I don't know. Let us know in the comments, how much are you spending per week or per month on your dating right about now? Because I think about it, some of the most money I wasted, think about like back to years ago, were on dates that just didn't go anywhere. I think to myself, like, what was the whole point? Wow. And a lot of it, you kind of know it's not going to go anywhere anyway, but you just kind of feel like, you know what, I kind of feel like I need to date.
So if a guy or woman is taking someone out on their first date, what would you say is like a reasonable amount of money to spend on?
Do you know what? I don't even know what's reasonable. It depends on what you're doing. Keep it simple. Take them to Nando's. Don't do that. I don't know. Keep it simple. You know, keep it simple is what I'd say. But I think the bigger point is only go into a date if it's someone you are serious about. Now, I get it. Obviously, people go into dates for different reasons. Some people just want, you know, bit of action.
Yeah.
You know, that's what some people want. But I just think that's an area that I'm glad I'm not wasting money on, obviously, in the way that I did in the past. So
I would probably say, in order to keep costs low, maybe keep it conversations on the phone, just get to know each other a bit more, and then you can kind of like determine if this is somebody you actually want to invest in. Obviously, when you meet each other face to face, it might be a bit different.
Friends.
But keep the phone calls for as long as possible, maybe even Zoom calls. Make an excuse as to why you can't meet up more. I'm not saying lie, but keep it on the phone for as long as possible.
What do you guys think? Actually, jump in the comments. This point about dating is actually
it's
one that
controversial.
I like the controversial bit. It's what makes it interesting, right? Can you relate to the point on dating? Do you feel like your monies that you put into your dates have been a good, shall I say, investment?
Yeah.
Has it been worth your while?
But what I would say,
as I say, useless dates. Anyway, go on then.
If you know that this person could be a potential lifetime partner, then do invest.
Do it, yes. Do like, your thing, exactly.
No, don't go all out, but be intentional and creative in how you invest in that relationship.
Guys, thank you so much for watching today's video. If you really enjoyed it, we appreciate you hitting the subscribe button. Show some love for the work we put into our channel.
And please do share this video with somebody if you think they'll find it useful. Like, share, and subscribe, all the good stuff. And as always, guys,
in all things, be thankful and seek joy. Take care.
Bye.